Hello. In today's module, we will be discussing about theories of motivation. Now, this is a very important concept, and let's understand what exactly it means. Motivation, it is derived from a Latin word mover, which means to move or to energize or to activate. Motivation, it refers to the way in which urges, drives, desires, aspirations, or needs direct, control, and explain the behavior of human beings. Now, before moving on to the theories of motivation, let's classify the needs or motives. So, needs can be classified in three different categories. One is primary needs, another one is secondary needs, and the third one is general needs. What are primary needs? They are also known as physiological, biological, basic needs. And these are the animal drives which are essential for survival, which includes food, shelter, clothing, good health, education, etc. Then we also have secondary needs. They are known as learned needs or derived needs. They are not biological or basic in nature, and it can be derived or taken care of. That is power, achievement, status, affiliation, etc. There's another category of needs which might not be learned, and at the same time it's not completely physiological in nature. So it could be competence, curiosity, affection. So a human being tries to fulfill all these types of needs in order to motivate himself or herself. Now let's move on to the various theories of motivation. The first and foremost theory of motivation, which is a very important theory, was given by Abraham Maslow. He was a psychologist who studied positive human qualities and the lives of exemplary people. In 1954, Maslow created the hierarchy of human needs and expressed his theories in his book, Motivation and Personality. So this particular theory of motivation is mentioned in the book, Motivation and Personality. Now Maslow, he gave a hierarchy of needs, that is in a pyramidal structure, in which he explained how needs can be classified and how we achieve different needs. So the basic level, or at the lowermost level, we have the physiological needs. That includes breathing, food, water, sex, sleep, homeostasis, excretion. So these are basic needs that one requires for their survival. Once these needs are satisfied, he or she, an individual, moves towards the higher level need, which is known as a safety need. Now, in the safety need, a person tries to fulfill his safety needs, which includes, let's say, employment, getting money, or making a house for himself. So, basically, safety of the family, health, and property. This is what they try to achieve in this particular level. Now, once a person achieves these particular needs, he moves on to another higher level, which is known as a love and belongingness. This is also an important level where he tries to find out, let's say, or tries to discover friendship, family, and intimacy with individuals. Once these needs are satisfied, a person moves towards the esteem needs. That is, he looks forward for self-esteem, confidence, achievement, respect of others, respect by others. These needs all again motivate individuals. Now many people, they finish their life at the esteem level and they're not able to actually reach this particular self-actualization level. Not many people are able to reach this highest level in the need hierarchy theory. Now what exactly is self-actualization? It is a person's motivation to reach his or her full potential. So it includes terms like morality, creativity, spontaneity, problem-solving nature, lack of prejudice, and acceptance of facts. So all these things will be included, or all these things will motivate an individual when he or she reaches the self-actualization level. Now some points to remember for Maslow's need hierarchy theory are, first of all, the needs have a certain priority. An individual cannot first reach the self-actualization level and then move on to the physiological needs. So he has to move in the certain order, that is from physiological needs to the safety needs, to the love and belonging needs, to the self-esteem needs, and then the self-actualization needs. That is how it has a priority. As the basic needs are satisfied, an individual seeks to satisfy the higher needs. So once the physiological needs are satisfied, then an individual will move towards the safety needs. If the basic needs are not met, then efforts to meet higher needs are postponed. So if the basic needs are not able to be satisfied, then one cannot reach the higher level. Various need levels, they are interdependent and they are overlapping. It's not distinct levels, that is, but they are interdependent. They are dependent on each other and they overlap to some extent. One need does not disappear when the other need appears. So that doesn't mean if we have reached a safety level, then all our physiological needs will be disappeared. We will need those needs also, but at the same time, we are looking for higher needs. Now, another theory of motivation was given by Herzberg, that is Frederick Herzberg, and the theory is known as Herzberg's motivation hygiene theory. Now, Frederick Herzberg, he conducted a study at Case Western Reserve University, where it was an analysis of the experience and feelings of about 200 engineers and accountants in 9 different companies. What did he study? They were asked to describe a few things in their job where they felt exceptionally good and exceptionally bad about their job. So he wanted to classify certain factors where employees felt very good about their job and they also felt very bad about their jobs. What were those factors? So he came out with 2 different categories of factors. One is known as hygiene factors. Another one is known as motivation factors. Now, what is hygiene factor? What are these factors? These are those job conditions which dissatisfy employees when they are absent, but their presence does not motivate them. For example, let's take the term hygiene only. If, let's say, your washroom or your bedroom is not hygienic, it is very dirty and very messy, will you like it? No. You will be dissatisfied because the hygiene factor is absent. But at the same time, if your room is done properly, if it is neat, it doesn't mean it will motivate you, or you will really, the presence will really motivate you. Now, similarly, there are factors which are opposite to the hygiene factors, that is known as motivational factors. What are these factors? These are some job conditions which build strong motivation and job satisfaction when they are present, but their absence rarely proves dissatisfying. So it is just the opposite. If it is present, it will be the individuals will be motivated. But if they are not present or if they are absent, then it does not really mean that the person will be dissatisfied. Now let's take some of the examples of hygiene factors and motivational factors. So in hygiene factors, we could include company policies, relationship with boss, supervision, work conditions, and salary. So let's take the example of salary and relationship with your boss. So if the salary is good, then you will be okay, you will not be really motivated to work harder. Oh my God, my salary is very good, I should work harder. Nothing like that. But if your salary is low or if it is not as you expected, then you will definitely be dissatisfied. But in case of motivators, let's say recognition, achievement, responsibility, advancement. If somebody recognizes your work, if they praise your work, you will be motivated. So if these factors are present, you will be motivated. But if somebody does not praise you, that doesn't mean you will be demotivated. It's okay. You'll just continue doing your work. So these are known as motivational factors. Another theory was given by McGregor, and it is known as theory X and theory Y. So McGregor has given certain assumptions which are involved in motivating employees. So these assumptions, he has characterized it into 2 opposite directions. One assumption, theory is theory X. These assumptions about human nature are negative in nature. And then we have theory Y. These assumptions about human nature are positive. So theory X, what does theory X say? These are the assumptions that he felt was that employees, they dislike work, they are lazy, they dislike responsibility, and they must be coerced to perform, or they must be pressurized and forced to perform some work. And in case of theory Y, he took the category of people, or he assumed that employees, they like work, they are creative, they seek responsibility, and they can exercise self-direction. So how did he relate it to the motivation? He said that theory X managers, that is those managers whose employees they dislike work and they are not interested in doing work, for them to motivate, in order to motivate them, he needs to have autocratic leadership style. That is, he should use extensive supervision and control. There should be little delegation of work, and motivation can be given by their pay or their salary. Okay, that is how theory X managers should deal with their employees. But in case of theory Y managers, because their employees, they like work, they are motivated, they are creative. So in that case, they have to use democratic and participative leadership style. That is, they can be delegation of work. There should be two-way communication. He should listen to the employees also, and he should empower the employees also. That is how the strategy should be used in order to motivate theory Y kind of employees. Another theory, important theory, is theory Z. Now, this approach is based on the combination of American and Japanese management philosophies. It was identified by William Auchi in 1981 in the book Theory Z, How Americans Can Meet Japanese Challenge. This was the name of the book. And it is a blend of Theory X and Theory Y. So he is Mr. William Auchi, and he has given the book Theory Z, How American Business Can Meet the Japanese Challenge. What are the features of Theory Z? Trust. If there is trust, integrity, and openness, then employees are highly motivated and chances of conflicts will minimize. So trust is a very important feature which should exist in the organization in order to motivate employees. Another feature of Theory Z was that there should be a strong bond between organization and employees. And how can they develop this strong bond? By giving them methods like lifetime employment or helping them in their career planning. That is how they can develop a strong bond. Employee involvement was another feature of Theory Z. It basically helps in increasing commitment among employees and in also giving them recognition when it is due. Another feature of Theory Z was no formal structure. There should not be any formal structure, but there should be perfect teamwork like a basketball team. Last feature of Theory Z was that there should be coordination of human beings. That is, there should be people should coordinate with each other, and this has to be taken care of by the leader. I hope this video was helpful for you. Thanks for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.